First thing, okay, is airway plus cervical mobilization. So now patient's already here. You already assessed the response. Patient was unresponsive. Okay. So what's the next thing you're supposed to do?
Coma seen, why is coma? Is there any polyvagal?
Okay. So you want to first is airway. So airway, you want to check the airway. But before even you check the airway, what's the first thing you're supposed to do? First thing is you need to maneuver and open up the airway first. Okay, so what is the maneuver you want to do? Head tilt, chin lift, or jaw thrust?
Jaw thrust.
You want to do jaw thrust, okay? Because in jaw thrust, in trauma, you want to stay away from head tilt and chin lift because you may cause some cervical injury. Okay, so now assuming that, so you want to do a jaw thrust. So how you do a jaw thrust? You want to demonstrate how to do a jaw thrust? Come.
Finger behind the finger mandible, then put forward.
Yes, okay, but you don't want to move the cervical column, right? So put your fingers at the angle of mandible, okay, the thumb over the maxilla region, and just gently lift up the airway, okay? Gently lift up the mandible and open up the airway. So you do a head tilt chin lift, all right? Jaw thrust. So you do a jaw thrust to open up the airway. So once you do a jaw thrust, then you see the airway open up, okay? Why you need to do a jaw thrust? Most of the time, patients have airway obstruction because they are unconscious, their tongue becomes floppy and falls back and blocks the airway. So when you do a jaw thrust, a maneuver, you move the tongue away from the vocal cord so patient can breathe normally. Okay? So first thing is jaw thrust. So after you do jaw thrust, what is next? If you're worried that you may actually cause some cervical injury while maneuvering the airway, you can ask the person in charge of airway to do a inline cervical mobilization. Okay? So please show how you do inline cervical mobilization. But I'm here.
Huh?
You're disturbing me. Yes, you can go from the front. Okay, just go from the front. Gently, okay, gently support the cervical column. Okay, just go in front and gently support the cervical column with your hands or palms resting on the shoulder. Okay, resting on the shoulder and just support the cervical column. So this is your inline cervical immobilization. Okay, now. After doing inline cervical mobilization, okay, somebody's doing inline cervical mobilization, so you do a, first you do a jaw thrust. So after doing jaw thrust, what is next? Okay, now you want to check for, because you want to visualize the airway, right? So you do jaw thrust, you can visualize the airway. Now you want to remove any foreign body. So how are you going to remove the foreign body? Just say, if you see like there is a fish head. Yes, I had a patient with fish head before. Okay, he was going fishing and then the fish just jumped into his head. He beat the head and the head ended up lodged in this airway. Alright? Yes, true story. Okay? True story. That one also palpitations. Okay? Alright. Okay. So you open up, you see grass, stones, some Hello Kitty small toy there. Okay, so what are you gonna do?
Remove.
Okay, very good. Airway obstruction is number one in our life-threatening. What is the mnemonic for all the life-threatening injuries that can kill the patient in? Atom FC. Okay, like a football team, Atom FC. So A stands for? Airway obstruction. So here we are going to address airway obstruction. So when you see something obstructing there, you see some stone, something that you can visualize, how are you going to remove it? Can I use my finger? Go in. You can use your fingers, but you have to be confident. My fingers are huge. If I go in, I know I'm going to just push things even further in and create a worse problem. Alright? So because of that, if you're confident, you could do a finger sweep, but usually we do not encourage finger sweep. You can use a marginal forceps and remove the foreign body. So remove whatever foreign body you see first. Okay? Jaw thrust, remove all the foreign body. Then after that, what is next? Okay. After that, you reach for your suction. Click on, eh? Okay. Okay, so now we want to use this Yonker heart suction. Okay, why? Although you removed any foreign body that you can see, sometimes saliva, secretion like blood, vomitus can also block the airway. So you need to do a suction. So immediately put your suction inside, okay, and clear the airway as much as possible. Okay, now when you're doing a suction, you're also doing another thing. What are you looking for? Besides just clearing the secretion. This suction has got a 2-in-1 purpose. Okay? What is the next thing? I put this tube into your mouth. What's going to happen?
Get reflex.
Get reflex. Yes. Okay? So, okay. What happens? Why am I looking for gag reflex? What does gag means? Which cranial nerve controls gag reflex? Glossopharyngeal. Betul? Glossopharyngeal, right? Correct. Glossopharyngeal is 9, right? Okay. So glossopharyngeal will control a gag reflex. If there's no gag reflex, what does that tell you? The brain stem is injured because your glossopharyngeal comes from the your pons, okay, midbrain, pons, medulla, from the pons, okay. So it comes from the pons, yes, pons, okay. So because of that, there could be brainstem injury. So it tells you that the prognosis is poor if patient does not have gag reflex, okay. So now you do, there's no gag reflex. If there is no gag reflex, you can put an adjunct airway. If there is gag reflex, you cannot put an adjunct airway, because if you put a, when there is gag reflex, you put an adjunct airway there, an oropharyngeal airway, you're going to stimulate gag and patient is going to vomit and patient is going to have aspiration, and aspiration is bad because the moment patient has aspiration, the chance, the mortality is already 1 out of 3 patients who develop aspiration will go on to develop aspiration pneumonitis, and patient will eventually pass away due to complication. All right, 1 out of 3. So you want to prevent aspiration as much as possible. Okay, so because of that, you do suction, see for gag. So if there's no gag, then only you can insert your oropharyngeal airway. How to insert an oropharyngeal airway?
Measure the size.
You want to measure the size. How you measure the size? From the
angle.
Okay. There are a few ways to measuring. Measuring, okay. But one of the easiest of ways of measuring is from the. Okay, from your pinna to the angle of the mouth. Okay, so it's very simple. From here to here. Okay. So you just measure here, from the pinna to the angle of the mouth, okay? Then you see that the size is adequate. And then you insert the oropharyngeal airway. You cannot insert something that's too small or too big. If the oropharyngeal is too small, what will happen is that it will actually push the tongue downwards and block the airway. If it's too long, then the oropharyngeal airway itself will block the airway. Alright? So you measure the size from your pinna to the angle of the mouth, okay, triggers to the end of the mouth and angle of the mouth, and when the size is adequate, then you insert. How you insert this oropharyngeal airway? Upside down, right? You see them usually, they won't straight away. Only for pits only you will straight away put it in, but for adults they will go in halfway. This mannequin has got no mouth opening, so it's a bit difficult, right? So you go in halfway and then you turn and then you push it in. Why you do this specific maneuver? You go in halfway against the heart palate, then you turn it, okay, you turn it 180 degrees, and then you go in. Why?
To push the tongue.
You do that so that you avoid from pressing the tongue downwards to block the airway. Alright, so you do it this way so that you follow the contour of the tongue, so that if you just put it in straight away, then you might actually push the tongue and block the airway. So you go in halfway and then you turn and go in, so that you do not end up pushing the tongue and blocking the airway. Understand? Okay. So once the oropharyngeal airway is in place, then what do you do next? But remember, only patients that do not have gag reflex. Then what do you do next?
High flow mask.
Then you put your high flow mask. Okay. Which is better, high flow mask or ambu bagging? Is there ambu bag here? Can somebody bring the ambu back from there? The bigger one, ada besarnya. Ada, ha? Okay, it's alright. Okay, so why we prefer to use? Okay. If patient can protect his airway, alright, if the saturation is good, 95% and above, alright, Although patient is unconscious, but if patient can maintain his airway with oropharyngeal airway, we prefer to use a high flow mask rather than do ambu bagging. Why? Okay, so we assume the oropharyngeal airway is already in place. Okay, why? Why do I not want to ambu bag the patient? Why is ambu bagging almost like Justin Bieber? Why? Hope you're not Justin Bieber fan. No. Okay lah. Yeah, okay. Only. Go back. Why this fella? He talks so bad about my idol. Okay, alright. So, why? If patient can maintain, SpO2 is more than 95. If the SpO2 is dropping, then you ambu bag. Okay? Then you may need to prepare for intubation. But we, as if possible, we try to avoid from intubating in primary survey. Why? Unless it's a crash intubation. Otherwise, we try to wait. If patient can maintain this airway, we don't try to intubate. Why? Because intubation, okay, especially when you do rapid sequence induction, will take time. And you may miss other life-threatening injuries, which is going to make the patient deteriorate. Understand? So primary survey is supposed to be done very quickly. Most 10 minutes, 5 to 10 minutes. That's how fast you need to do a primary survey. Within 10 minutes, done. Okay? So if you're going to do RSI, you're going to be stuck at airway. You won't be able to proceed to breathing and circulation. You may miss something life-threatening. Okay? Can? Alright. So because of that, we try to use high flow mask as much as possible. So although patient unconscious, you need to intubate. Because you know that patient won't be able to protect his airway. But later in the secondary survey. Okay? So, as long as you put the oropharyngeal airway, you suction, you put the high flow mask, you look at the SpO2. If the person in charge of breathing tells you that the SpO2 is good, 95% and above, okay, patient is able to maintain his saturation, then you can proceed. If the saturation is dropping despite your clearing of the airway, okay, then you should consider intubating at this stage because airway is important. Otherwise, patient is going to crash, oxygenation, patient is going to develop hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy, and you don't want that. Because if patient survives, patient's only going to come with in a vegetable state. Okay? Understand? So always remember, clear the airway, put high flow mask, see the saturation. If it's okay, proceed. Boleh? Okay, nah? Alright. So what's next after airway? So just to recap, airway, what's the first thing you need to do? Not clear the airway. Before that, position the airway properly. So how are you going to position the airway? Jaw thrust, very good. So after jaw thrust will be? Okay, very good. So you clear all the foreign body. Very good. Then what's next?
Suction.
Okay, you do suction. Okay. Okay. So if there is no gag reflex, you insert the oropharyngeal airway. Measure the size and insert properly according to the technique. Okay, then after that, put the high flow mask. Okay, after airway, who's airway's best friend?
Cervical
immobilization. So now we're going to learn how to insert the cervical collar. Okay. What is the indication? Do all trauma patients need cervical collar? There must be some guide, right? Emergency, impossible. Response, AVPU. Cervical collar, are we just going to just randomly decide which patient needs cervical collar and who does not need cervical collar? We still have a system. So what's the system we use? Okay, the system we use is known as the Nexus criteria. Nexus criteria. Pernah dengar Nexus criteria? Yes, you've heard of it, right? So what is the Nexus criteria? Okay, this Nexus criteria is very easy to remember. That's why I prefer to use Nexus. There are other criteria which are better sensitivity and specificity. But I prefer to use Nexus because it's easier to remember. The indication whether a patient needs a cervical collar or not is NSAID. NSAID. As long as you have one, patient is already indicated for a cervical collar insertion. Okay? N stands for? Neurological deficit. Patient does not have a neurological deficit. If patient has neurological deficit, patient complain of numbness or paralysis over any parts of the body, okay? Then you know that patient has a neurological deficit, you need to immediately apply a cervical collar. Okay? And it's neurology. Bo, don't worry, Bo, don't have to take notes. The notes are perfect, everything is there, all right? Just need to be at the moment. Appreciate, absorb the moment. Be one with the moment. Okay, all right. All right, next is S. What is S? Spinal tenderness, patient complains of pain over the neck or on gentle palpation, patient complains of pain. Then you know that there could be some cervical injury there. So spinal tenderness, also an indication to put cervical collar. A, altered sensorium, okay? Patient come unconscious, poor conscious level, then you also you'll be unable to assess whether the patient needs cervical collar. Please apply a cervical collar. I, intoxication, patient comes smelling of alcohol, or from the history, somebody tells you the patient has taken some form of drugs, you are unable to access, you're unable to assess, immediately put a cervical collar. D, distracting pain. Patient comes screaming in pain. My leg is so painful. Okay? Patient has an amputated lower limb. And if you press the neck, and do you have any pain? Do you think he'll be able to respond? No, because there's some pain that's even worse elsewhere. So even if there's some mild pain or moderate pain here, he won't be able to tell you because there is a distracting pain elsewhere. So as long as you've got one, you need to insert the cervical collar. But as I said, nowadays people are moving away from cervical collar. Why? Why is it people are starting to see cervical collar like Justin Bieber? Why? Why? Because cervical collar, number one, is very uncomfortable. Have you tried putting one on yourself? Yeah, you should, it's nice, okay? It's nice for you to experience how patients feel. You see, you need to experience what the patients feel, okay? Because we put cervical collar, so you need to put on yourself. Okay, you should try it, okay? So when you put a cervical collar on yourself, it's very uncomfortable, right? So that's one, it's very uncomfortable. Two, what are you compressing? You're compressing your external jugular vein. And what happens when you compress an external jugular vein? CSF, your cerebral spinal fluid, drains from the aeronaut villi into the internal jugular vein. Okay? And it will drain into your right atrium. So when you compress the jugular vein, okay, the external jugular vein, and which will eventually lead to increased pressure in the internal jugular vein, then what happens is that the cerebral spinal fluid cannot drain because of the high pressure in your jugular veins. Then what happens is that your intracranial pressure increases. Is that good for head injury? So that is why now, unless truly indicated, then only we put. Okay? There's another problem. Whenever somebody at site or paramedics already put the cervical collar, when the patient comes, cervical collar is already on. We cannot remove until we clear and do a cervical X-ray or CT. That's usually how we think, right? Do you know, as a medical provider, you can remove the cervical collar if it's not needed. So when patient comes, now you already cleared the airway, patient is already on cervical collar, you want to assess whether the patient needs the cervical collar or not. Very simple, use the same criteria. The same criteria can be used to remove a cervical collar. Patient no neurological deficit, no spinal tenderness, patient is full conscious level, not intoxicated, no distracting pain, he can move, he can, while wearing the cervical collar, eat nasi kawok. Okay? Alright. Okay? So you have seen patients so comfortable eating nasi kawok, turning here, you know, screaming, dancing with the cervical collar on. No need. You can remove it. And it's justified because you followed a criteria. This is a very well-known nexus criteria. Okay? So remember, live, breathe, and eat nexus criteria. Okay? Alright. Now. So you got the cervical collar. So how are you going to insert the cervical collar? It's indicated, patient is unconscious, okay? Your heart rate is now at 220, okay? Alright? Either he's going to collapse or you are going to collapse, okay? So now, how are you going to measure the cervical collar? From the angle of the mandible to the base of the neck, how many finger breaths? Okay? How many finger breaths, okay? Patient, not you, huh? Patient, come, you're doing... Alright, okay? Alright. So now, so you measure from the angle of the mandible to the base of the neck, and you see, so this patient is 4 finger breaths. This cervical collar is an adjustable cervical collar. You have the posterior portion and the anterior portion. Okay, usually the part that connects these both sections will be the place you can adjust the length. So you can see here, they've already marked for you. No neck. Yeah, can you see here? You can see there's no neck, short, regular, and tall. So this is where you adjust the cervical collar. Alright? So if it's 2 finger breaths, it comes under short. 3 comes under regular, 4 comes under tall. Okay? So now as you can see, that in this patient he needs is 4 finger breaths. So it comes under tall. So you need to readjust the cervical collar. Okay? Pull it to tall. Okay, then you can adjust from regular to tall and lock the cervical collar. Okay? Unfortunately, some cervical collars are unadjustable. Okay? Like for example, this one. Okay? This is an unadjustable cervical collar. So in this case, you have like this regular, short neck, no neck cervical collars. So you also same, you measure at the part that connects the posterior and the anterior portion. So you can see it's 4 finger breadths. Okay? Boleh, eh? Okay. So once you've adjusted, you need to apply the cervical collar. How do you apply the cervical collar? Somebody needs to constantly put the inline cervical immobilization. So who was my inline cervical immobilization guy? Okay, please, from the front. Yes, from the front you do inline cervical immobilization. Okay, now you want to gently insert. So you want to stabilize the head and gently insert the cervical collar. Okay. Okay. Okay, so gently insert the cervical collar. Right? Now, okay, gently insert the cervical collar. Okay. Okay, gently insert the cervical collar. How you know whether the cervical collar is too tight or too loose? You must check for fitting. So at least one finger should be able to pass underneath. If you can put more than two fingers in, it's too loose. If you cannot even put one finger in, it's too tight. Okay, you must make sure that it is not too tight. Okay? And when do you know you have reached the proper length for you to strap the cervical collar? Usually if you come here, look over here, at the cervical collar, you can see two markings over here. Okay? So in roughly when you can visualize both markings, is the time that you can actually insert the cervical collar. Alright? But of course it varies from patient to patient, but this is just a rough guide. Okay? So you stabilize, put it in, okay? Okay, stabilize, put it in and strap. Okay? And check for fitting. Okay? Clear? Okay. So that is Airway Plus cervical immobilization.